Hi, I'm John Tronfeld with University of Maryland Extension. We're here on site today in Baltimore City at the Hampstead Hill Academy. We're going to tour the school garden, and we're lucky to have as our host Chrissa Carlson, who's the Garden and Nutrition Educator at the school. Thanks for having us today, Chrissa.
Thanks for coming out.
So, Chrissa, you have a beautiful garden here. Can you tell us a few things about how you got started here at Hampstead Hill?
The garden at Hampstead Hill is part of the Food for Life program, which is a food education program that tries to encourage healthy eating habits through hands-on positive experiences with food. So a garden is a great way to do that. This is the sixth season for the garden. It started as a couple of raised beds, and after 2 or 3 years doubled in size. We also have border perennials, native perennials, and some ornamentals, as well as a sensory garden. And then this past year we got a grant from Lowe's Charitable Foundation to expand some of the infrastructure in the garden that helps the garden be maintained by families by providing access to tools. And it also helps it serve as a demonstration site to the community of best practices for sustainable gardening. So we added rain barrels and a rainwater harvesting arbor. We also added some benches that provide a gathering space. So it's founded in the food education, but it has grown to encompass, you know, environmental education, family and community learning, as well as the in-school education.
Well, it's very inspiring, but of course, if you're just starting out, it can look a little overwhelming. So how would you advise a new teacher in a school to go about actually starting a garden? Mm-hmm.
I would definitely advise starting small and think about what a small garden would be and then half it in size. The maintenance of a school garden is completely different than a home garden. What might seem like your relaxing time after work when you go out to water and weed just doesn't fit well into a school day. Containers is a great way to start, or maybe one or two raised beds. I do like raised beds that are actually framed with wood or another material, because it does make it very clear where your feet go and where they do not go for the young gardeners. But even if you are starting small, it's nice to have your grand vision in mind so that you don't paint yourself into a corner. So get the kids working on sort of grand schemes. Give them some options of things to choose from, some garden elements that maybe 2, 3, 4 years down the road they'd like to have in, and then you can start with one piece of that. Getting kids involved in that design process can be a little challenging. There's a reason why kids aren't landscape designers. Don't count on them to come up with ideas. It's just not in their awareness, but to find pictures of those things and then have them choose and then create a map and then create sort of your master plan and then figure out how you can incrementally build on that. Having that plan as well is going to help you do fundraising. It's a lot easier to fundraise for a specific materials and supplies than it is to fundraise for, like, oh, just, you know, support our garden.
It sounds like the garden has been fully incorporated into the school and its curriculum. How important is that the teachers, parents, everybody is on board with the garden?
I think that that is something to shoot for, but to not get unrealistic at the beginning that you think that everybody in the school is going to be as excited about it as you are. It's just important to be clear about who is taking on what responsibilities for the garden. And if you start small and you get those systems in place and the space itself becomes an asset to the school, then you can recruit broader support. It's absolutely important that the administration is on board to make sure that the grounds folks are expected to do their part, or at least, you know, facilitate any things that you need. As far as having every student in the school able to interact with the garden, that probably will come at a later stage when there are more people who have seen its value. You might want to start with doing nutrition education or science, but then eventually it can become something that cuts across curriculum.
A lot of teachers are interested, but how much does it take to actually get a garden started? And how do you keep it going?
Well, if you're starting small with a couple of raised beds or containers, a couple $100 will get you pretty far. I figure it costs about $100 with soil included to build a 4x8 raised bed. The biggest cost with soil is getting delivery, so if you can really mobilize resources within your community, if you've got somebody with a pickup truck, that'll save you a lot of money on that. You can get seeds for free from a lot of seed companies, last year's seeds. But for small funds, again, when you're at the small beginning stages, just soliciting your local businesses for donations might be an easier way to get started than thinking you have to go for a gigantic grant. Once you do have a grand scheme in mind is when then you'll be more empowered to write small grants. The grant I got for the garden this year from Lowe's was $5,000, and that was a big chunk. I mean, that's funded every plant in the garden. It funded the arbor, it funded the shed, it funded two benches. So you can get pretty far on a shoestring. And then as far as ongoing needs, once you have the garden established, funding your seeds and your plants, and for sort of the petty cash stuff, we do things like I took photos that the kids took of the gardens and we sold buttons at school events. Other things that we've done was painted wooden spoons and decoupaged on pictures from seed catalogs, and then shellacked them so that you can stick those in your garden, and we sold those. Selling herbs at school events, so little things like that that you can sell are a great way to raise petty cash that'll get you those seasonal needs that you don't need a huge amount of money for, but you know, $100 worth of seeds and seedlings will get you pretty far.
Can you tell us about some of the specific design features, why the garden is located where it is? We notice you have this nice pergola, there's a collection system for rainwater, you have shaded areas, a nice tool shed. Can you talk about some of those things?
Yeah, a lot of those things came up around this year, and again, were sort of meant to be things that took the garden from being a, you know, already thriving space for growing food, it really made it more functional as a classroom and a demonstration site. Adding vertical elements to the garden is going to create visual interest, and it's striking, and also in urban spaces, space to trellis plants is important. It is located right on Fleet Street on a fairly busy thoroughfare, which I think is kind of opposite to what people usually think, that, oh, we're worried about vandalism, let's tuck it away behind the school. I think tucking it away makes it easier for people to go and destroy things or steal things. So putting it on the street, it seems risky at first, but it puts it out in space and it says, hey, this is here for the community to enjoy and not just something that's kind of this like secret space of the school. So yeah, so we have the arbor, which serves a lot of functions. It is a space for trellising plants. It does provide a little bit of shade, which is going to be really important when you're trying to get kids out there and engaged. Having them roasting in the sun isn't a great way to do it. So having a little place where you can duck into the shade when you want to have their full attention. We also have benches, which is really important for me to have kids all be able to go somewhere at the same time. When I let kids loose in there, you know, I have 4 or 5 year old students, I literally can't see them. So I try to balance the sort of free exploration time with the structure, like we have a job to do time, so whether it's turning the compost, watering, or checking for bugs, you know, everybody has a set job. During that time, there's also kind of free exploration. I give them about 10 minutes, and then we do a garden cheer, and then everybody goes to the benches. And just being able to gather them all together makes a huge difference. Integrating flowers and artwork in the garden is really gonna help kind of establish the space, have the kids take interest in it early in the season, because your vegetables aren't really going to start to pop till towards the end of the school year. So we've painted stepping stones, we made birdhouses out of gourds that we grew last year. That kind of stuff kind of just makes it more engaging from the beginning of the season.
Now the soil looks really rich here. We're in an urban area in Baltimore City. So how did you build up the soil to get it this good?
Well, the soil in the raised beds is imported from elsewhere, so it's brought in. And that is another advantage of raised beds, is you have a contained area that you can load with your amended rich soil. So that's all been brought in. If you do have poor soil or contaminated soil, you know, you can put down a barrier cloth and garden on top of that and then bring in your own soil. In other gardens that I've done where I was working in the native soil, just as much leaf compost as I could get in there. It's a reasonably priced, it's accessible, and it's a local product if you're getting either the Baltimore City municipal leaf compost or the bagged leaf grub.
Raised beds, mm-hmm. How do you build them? How do you use them? A lot of educators are very interested in using raised beds as sort of the centerpiece of a mm-hmm. student garden.
I've always just used untreated lumber, 2x12, some people use 2x10 lumber. The dimensions are important. You want to have it no wider than 4 feet. For kids, I think 3 feet is a good width. The width is so that you can reach in without having to step on the soil that you're going to be spending some money and effort to get into there. But the length can be any dimension. Ours are 8 feet, and that is a fairly manageable size board. But really, the length isn't as important, so work around what's reasonable for you. And you can really just take 3-inch wood screws and just drilling pilot holes will make sure you get them in without splitting the wood. You know, just screw them from face of one board into the end of the next.
And if you make walkways between your beds, can you just throw that soil from the walkways into the raised bed to help fill
yeah,
it up?
Yeah, absolutely. Because yeah, that is the one thing with raised beds is that it does become an expense getting the soil in there. Anything that you can do to just constantly be adding organic matter, because it will settle, and obviously you want to be replenishing the nutrients as well.
And I noticed a lot of grapes. Tell us about fruit in the garden here.
Yeah, fruits, you know, everybody I think shies away from fruit because they get intimidated by all the, you know, there's pruning and there's, you know, there's all the fungal diseases and stuff. And I think the urban heat island has benefited us that the fruit itself dries pretty quickly after the rain because of the heat reflected off of the solid surfaces. So that hasn't been a problem. But the other thing that I look at is that the goals of a school garden are very different than the goals of an orchardist. Our yield is not important. What's important is we get something and that the kids get to see it and, you know, maybe they taste one grape, but probably going to have a pretty big impact and seeing where that grape came from. So I don't think it's to be shied away from as long as you're not shot down if you do get black rot on your grapes.
Your rosemary is fabulous. Can you talk a little bit about the role of herbs in the garden and in your nutrition exercise?
Oh, absolutely. The herbs are wonderful. Number one, they're always there. The perennial herbs, you know, you'll be waiting almost to the end of the school year before you can pick any of your annual vegetables, but your herbs pop up there very early in the season. So when I start to get the students out there in the springtime, we do herb taste tests. Talk a lot in the food education class about seasoning things with herbs as a way to cut down on using salt and other unhealthy ingredients, but then also the role in the garden, of course, protection from pests. Bees love oregano flowers and other herb flowers, so they're just really a great thing to have.
And school administrators and parents are naturally going to be concerned about rats in a vegetable garden at school. And so are rats attracted to vegetable gardens, and what's been your experience here?
We do have rats that make their way through our garden, and we have had to treat some rat tunnels. My general feeling is that if rats are not already in the neighborhood, you are not going to establish a rat population by planting a vegetable garden. We see very, very little damage in the garden unless there are sweet things that end up on the ground if a tomato doesn't get picked or strawberries do get munched on. But again, there's plenty of other trash in the neighborhood that is really what they're subsisting on. So we did have a problem with rats in one of the beds this year, so we pulled all the vegetables, you know, disposed of those and treated that bed. And we're going to have to look at sort of the long term.
So how about plants you would discourage teachers from planting in a school garden?
Well, if you're going to plant mint, I would advise planting it in a container because it can become very invasive. It's a great thing to have. You know, kids love it and are thrilled and shocked to learn that mint wasn't invented by gum companies. But keeping it in a container is a good way. And there are just things that self-seed, like morning glories. They have a place in the garden, but just know that you're probably what might be a beautiful, you know, vining plant one year might be your worst weed the next. So it might be something that you want to wait until you have maintenance helpers before you plant things that can get a little bit more out of control.